Apartheid, a system of institutionalized racial discrimination that existed in South Africa from 1948. After a long time of suffering, the black community has started riots to speak up for their rights and formed a movement called the African National Party, or ANP. Tim walks down the street carrying two large bags, placing one in a dumpster and gestures to his partner Stephen, who picks up a bag and leaves it near some cars. Tim leaves his second bag near another trash pile and attaches the wire connections to the bomb. As he nervously walks away, a small explosion occurs with leaflets being scattered. They are part of apartheid, spreading the word that freedom and equality of all races should be fought for at all cost. Tim and Stephen attempt to flee the scene, but they get noticed and apprehended. Awaiting their prosecution, Tim's girlfriend sneaks into his room and gives him some money in case of need. She encourages him to stay strong. Before the court hearing, in the restroom, Tim hides the money in a cigar case and shoves it where the sun doesn't shine. 1978, in the courtroom, the judge praises the prosecution, which has presented an overwhelming amount of evidence of 26 custom-made bombs. As defense to their actions, they use that all races are equal, which is not taken well. The judge announces the sentence. Tim is sentenced to 12 years, as he's the main bomb maker, and Stephen to 8 years as an accomplice. As they prepare to leave the courthouse, Stephen notices his chance to escape through an open window, and he does, but in vain. When he reaches the ground, he is beaten up. They are brought to the prison of Pretoria, and the prison warden, Captain Schnabel, receives them with disgust, because he considers them traitors. He hands them over to a very strict prison officer, Meneer. As they follow Meneer, who explains the rules and regulations of the prison, Tim takes a close look at the automatic grille doors, the multiple barred gates, and the security systems in place. Everything seems tight. Meneer shows them their cells, which are closed by a grille and a full metal door. He tells them to keep the cells clean and they will have a good relationship. Tim barely gets any sleep. Day 1. At breakfast, Tim carefully strolls around to find a seat when Dennis gives him a hand. Dennis is an older political prisoner serving 4 life sentences for his work against apartheid. He tells Tim that the prisoners in the blue uniforms are murderers, while they themselves in the gray uniforms are political prisoners. They notice Stephen and make some ruckus to get his attention and join them. Dennis asks them about their sentences. Stephen confidently tells him for how long they are sentenced, but they don't plan on staying that long. A French prisoner, Leonard, eavesdrops on them. Potluck accidentally spills the soup and Meneer makes an example out of him. Later in the day, when the prisoners are exercising in the prison yard, Dennis tells them everything they need to know about the prison's layout, the height of the walls, the searchlight, and the guards, and advises them against trying to escape. Dennis tells them about the wall next to the public road, which is always guarded by a sniper. He also tells them that people always sneak in money with the idea of escaping within a week, but that does not happen, and advises Tim to give him the money for safekeeping before he gets an infection. After Dennis takes his leave, Leonard approaches the duo and says that Dennis always discourages anyone who talks about escaping. He believes it is possible and offers his help. In return, he wants to be included in their plan. Captain Schnabel observes them and finds them fishy. On Dennis' advice, Tim gets the cigar case out of his system and, at breakfast under the tables, passes the money over to other prisoners to Dennis, who hides it in a toothpaste wrapper. Day 23. With a lighted match, Tim looks at the keyhole to the grill gate in his cell as if it offers any answers. For multiple nights he stared at the lock as ideas ran through his head, but nothing stuck. Then finally one night it dawned on him, you start with what you know and work backwards. He has an idea. He uses paper to measure the keyhole and check its length. He wants to make wooden keys to open the doors. The next day, he shares this idea with Stephen and Leonard in the shower room. Leonard thinks the wooden key idea is nonsensical, but Stephen and Tim are sure it could work. They would get the wood from the workshop. Acting on the plan, Leonard creates a commotion in the cafeteria to get Meneer's attention. Tim carefully observes the shape of the key and later begins to draw it in his cell. He takes every opportunity to take a look at the key, whether it's during training or during their count, until he finally has a clear draft of it. Day 74. Tim steals sandpaper and wood from the workshop. He manages to hide them in his thermos, wrapped in cloth so they don't rattle. As Meneer checks the prisoners' thermoses one by one and Tim's turn comes, Meneer notices that he looks very stiff. His heart pounds as Meneer taps his thermos on the sink, but is relieved when he finds nothing suspicious. That same night, Tim works tirelessly on his first prototype. After some chiseling, his first key is ready. Tim tries it out and like a knife through butter, the gears turn and he opens the grilled door. However, there is one small problem, the all-metal door has no keyhole from inside the cell. That morning, Tim explains to Leonard and Stephen that they now need to make another key and also a way to open the door from the inside. After success with the first key, Leonard is fully on board. Tim takes every opportunity to observe the shape of the all-metal door key and eventually develops another wooden version. Day 100. While mopping the hallway, when there are no guards around, Leonard keeps watch and Tim tries out the key. It's not as smooth as the first one, so he chisels it a bit and successfully locks the door. The trio is thrilled with this fact. However, there is one small problem. He cannot reopen the door and even breaks off the key, leaving a piece stuck inside. Leonard signals that a guard is approaching. In the tense situation, Tim just manages to get part of the piece out before the big guard arrives. One crisis averted, but he could not push the lock back in. When it is time for the lock-in, Munir notices the lock sticking out, but pays no further attention to it and locks the door, to Tim's relief. It's the annual family prison visitation. Leonard's son comes to see him. Out of emotion, Leonard touches the glass and Munir takes this as an opportunity to interrupt the half-hour meeting and ends it. His son had brought him a handmade kite. This makes Leonard extremely frustrated. Day 142. Since the key worked, Stephen, Tim, and Leonard now discuss how to open the lock from their cells. Leonard suggests using the string from his son's kite to get the key out of the barred window, but this is of no use since they cannot turn it. When Leonard takes the broom to sweep, Stephen gazes at it and gets an idea. They measure the length of the broom to see if it reaches the lock from the inside. It is barely long enough. As Tim works in the workshop, he watches a turning machine. In his cell, he successfully develops a system with a similar concept that he attaches to the broom, and tries it out that night with a key attached. He succeeds with opening the door from the inside. Not without hiccups though, as the key falls down when he pulls it out. He does not give up and uses a piece of chewing gum to stick it back on the broom and barely manages to pull it in. The next morning, Tim is extremely excited as he tells Stephen and Leonard that he did not sleep a wink last night but managed to open the all-metal door. While on gardening duty, to lessen the stress of getting caught, they bury wooden keys in a jar. Munir notices them together, walks up to Tim and asks him what they were doing, suspecting something is up. Tim quickly explains that Stephen was just picking up his yard waste. Munir tells him to clean up his own mess. Dennis warns Tim to be careful and once again advises him against trying to escape, but says he will try to look out for them. One night Tim comes out of his cell and checks the stairwell. He informs the others that if they can unlock one door, they can unlock all the other doors and sneak out of the prison that way. Day 206. Nothing stays the same in prison, but nothing changes either. The routine remains the same and you find the cracks to exploit to make the most of it. Tim has made friends with Potluck. Through the window he asks him to get the roadmap and other errands they need for their escape. At breakfast, Potluck signals him about the goods and Munir takes note of this. The trade takes place at the dumpsters. Tim gets newspapers for some soap and ciggies. Day 296. Munir comes to Tim's cell to give him his new glasses, which he ordered, and to let him know that Potluck has been put down for smuggling. This makes Tim even more determined to escape, as he remembers his wife telling him to stay strong. That night, he and Leonard make dummies on their beds and get out of the cell. They carefully descend the stairs and approach the next grilled gate to try the keys. Right around the corner is the admin room. They know it is the night shift of the big guard, so they are warned a good time before his approach. They are still sweating with worry, but find one of the keys to this gate works. The big guard's music stops and he goes on a night patrol. Tim and Leonard hide in a closet and just manage to keep the door closed. As the big guard walks up the stairs in his slow walk, they sneak out and pass the admin room and try their keys on the next doors, opening them with success. Stephen signals with a cough that the guard is finishing his patrol and will return soon. They just manage to lock the door and hide in the closet as the guard descends the stairs. On his way back, the big guard notices the sweat but doesn't think much of it. The duo returns to their cells. Tim is overly excited and hides pieces of keys in a cup. That morning, Captain Schmuel with other guards enter Tim's cell. He has slept through the wake-up call. Schmuel curiously asks Tim if he is sick, implying that he wants to know the reason why he overslept. Schmuel's 20 years of experience tells him that he overslept because Tim is tired, and he is tired because he does not sleep at night. But all Tim can do is apologize. He is sent out and they search everyone's cells for clues. Tim is called back and the cup with his toothbrush falls over and the key pieces fall out. Captain Schmuel picks up one of them and asks what it is. Tim barely keeps his nerve and quickly comes up with an idea that he made them to hold up his parents' picture. Schmuel is sure that Tim is hiding something and vows to find out. It was a close call. The following night, Tim has a panic attack because his nerves give up, but he keeps going. He narrates that the obstacles presented a new way of looking at things so that the whole prison became their hiding place. For several nights they snuck out and kept making new keys for their escape. They begin to make many other preparations for their escape and manage to get civilian clothes from the laundry. Day 404. Tim gets a tooth infection and the nurse says he needs to be taken to the clinic. When Munir escorts him, Tim learns that there is a button to push to open the automatic door. He also sees that a new guard tower is being built. It is Christmas Eve and they have made all the preparations. Tim, Stephen and Leonard present their plan to Dennis and the other prisoners. They have made 39 keys for 15 separate doors. Dennis and the others argue that they have nowhere to go even if they get out. The group fails to convince anyone to join them in their escape. Dennis gives Tim his money back, disguised in a eucalyptus toothpaste. Munir sees the toothpaste on Tim's bed, but thinks it is a precaution for his tooth infection. Captain Schmbull, very suspicious that something is cooking, turns everything in Tim's cell upside down out of frustration, but finds nothing. In the evening, after all the officers have left, Tim, Stephen, and Leonard start to carry out their plan. Tim offers Dennis one last time to join them, but he refuses. They collect the keys, which are hidden in different areas of the prison, and change into civilian clothes. The big guard clogs the toilet and gets the plunger from the closet. He notices a twisted paper clip Leonard used to hold the closet door, but ignores it. The three make their way down the stairs, and when they hear footsteps, they hide in the closet but do not find the paper clip. They have no idea that the big guard is coming to the closet to put the plunger back. Just in time, Dennis smashes a light bulb in his cell, causing a short circuit. He calls out to the guard and distracts him. The trio is saved by the skin of their teeth and can continue their escape. They get all the keys they need in order and make their way through the doors as quickly as possible. Before they reach the last door, Leonard goes back and successfully opens the automatic door. Everything goes smoothly. The gate is wide open and they can see the street. It's beautiful. They hug each other and attempt to open the last door. That's when they realize that none of their keys work. Their dreams are shattered in an instant and Tim says they have to go back. They cannot go back. Leonard notices that the door frame is made of wood and using a screwdriver and a chisel, he tries to force the door open. He is loud and Tim is worried, but Leonard is determined. He manages to break it open and they sneak past the sniper. Confidently, they march out of the gate so as not to arouse suspicion. They find a taxi to take them out of Pretoria and laugh ecstatically, not believing they have made it. The next morning, Munir discovers that Tim, Stephen, and Leonard have disappeared. Stunned and angry, he sounds the alarm and all the prisoners laugh. Tim, Stephen, and Leonard reach London via Mozambique and Tanzania, where they continue to fight apartheid. Dennis was finally released 5 years later, in 1985. The end.